People put bars on their windows. People had guns in their homes. You were talking about people who slept in shifts. Some would stay up all night, some would take half the night, the others, and just watching, prepared with a gun in case anybody would come in. Hardware stores didn't have locks on the shelves anymore. Guns were going, flying off the shelves as well. Everybody was a suspect.
And this went on for months.
It went on for months. There was so much fear in the community. There were so many rumors.
Was there one common dominant thread in all of the attacks?
The one common dominant threat in all of the attacks is that I'm gonna kill you. Don't move. I'll kill you. I'll kill everybody in the house. He would go to the kitchen and get a plate or cups and saucers, and he would place it on the back of the victim and say, "If you move, I will kill your wife." And then the wife would be taken into the other room where she was sexually assaulted. He always spoke in with clenched teeth and through hushed tones. And he knew that nobody else in the house was going to wake up. He would wait until, you know, he knew everybody was in there sound asleep when these rapes happened.
It's not just an attack, really, is it? It's a form of torture.
It was a form of torture. It was the most evil type of attack and assault of any that I had worked in my career.
From all that you investigated, how do you think he chose his victims?
I think he chose his victims by prowling, and I think he chose his victims by seeing them somewhere and following them home.
So it was random prowling.
It was random prowling, but then I think he would see a victim, or he would drive through a neighborhood and he would see somebody and he would make a point and go back. Then the aftermath, it wasn't just when he left the victims, that was the end of it. There were phone calls, taunting. Even years later, he would call a victim and, "Remember me? Do you remember me?" And they knew that it was the rapist. So it was a constant fear. There was not one person who had been a victim that could walk down the street and not feel that anybody that she encountered could have been the rapist. It was a very, very uncomfortable feeling.
Is it helpful after all these years to have a face to all these crimes?
Oh, yes. For the last 42 years, all of the victims, you had almost 50 rape victims and all of the homicide victims, and it's their families. And for Sacramento, it wasn't just the victims, it was the community, it was law enforcement, it was everybody during that time that needed to have an ending to what had happened. They needed to know who he was. And it was amazing once he was identified and arrested.
What do you think he should get? What does he deserve?
I think Joe D'Angelo should get the death penalty. I'm a proponent of death penalty. And when you have a man who has murdered so many people in such a vicious, evil way and torn apart the lives of hundreds of people, he doesn't deserve to live.
You wouldn't think twice?
No, absolutely not.
Hello, I'm Liam Bartlett. Thanks for watching. To keep up with the latest from 60 Minutes Australia, make sure you subscribe to our channel. You can also download the 9Now app for full episodes and other exclusive 60 Minutes content.